You've learned about Azure SQL Database and developers. In this part two, we'll go even deeper on some of the architectures of Azure SQL Database on this episode of Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed, where we continue to expand on why Azure SQL Database is the best database for developers. I'm once again joined by Davide Mauri, a program manager on the SQL Database team. Welcome back.
Hey, Anna. Thank you. It's a pleasure again to be here.
Thanks for being here again. And today we're going to dive a little bit more into some of the architectures. So I think you had some examples that you're going to share with us today.
Yeah, right. So let me go straight to it. So again, I prepared just a couple of slides, and let's just, you know, go right to the point.
Sure.
The idea today is to discuss with you some of the architecture we saw applied successfully with Azure SQL. The first is kind of related to the latest offering of Azure SQL that we have, Azure SQL Hyperscale, that enable, I would say, an extreme scale-out scenario. So let's say you have a mobile application or API or any write-heavy also solution, and you want to land all of this data as fast as possible in Azure SQL Hyperscale. So you can do that. As usual, Hyperscale can ingest data up to 100 terabytes, so you are not worried about scale. But what you are worried about is that enough clients can connect at the same time and consume that data. So they don't want maybe to write data anymore, but they want to read the data. This is a kind of a typical use case scenario when you have OLTP, where you have like 20, 30% writes and the majority, the rest is read. So for example, let's say you have a gaming application that is running on an Xbox and you have many people joining and using your massive online game. So they need to be able to query data about, I don't know, the item they have or where they are in the virtual world, whatever. At the same time, you also want to have administrator of this game being able to do some real-time analytic or HTAP, as it's called today. And so you have a kind of a very different workload between very fast and short reads that happen on, you know, a mobile or a console device, and then more complex and more analytical kind of queries that happens on Power BI or any other solution that you may want to use to do analytics. With Hyperscale, we can have today up to 4 replica, but we are working to improve that limit to much higher values. And what will happen is that you will immediately have available up to 4 read-only replicas that will read exactly from the same data source, from the same page server. That's how data is stored in Hyperscale, not in file, but in servers, in kind of microservices for storage. And they will read exactly from the same place where data is also written. So there is, I would say, there is no latency between the fact that an API writes into the primary node, the Hyperscale node, and the secondary replica allows you to read the data. And Hyperscale replicas can grow horizontally and so scale out very quickly and can support a huge number of queries per second or connection per second. And also this allows you to differentiate, like, as I said before, small, fast reads on a couple of secondary node and other more complex workload type of analytical queries into another node. So this was not something that can be easily done before Hyperscale. Thanks to the new architecture we have, this really enables a huge scale-out scenario. And talking about scale-out and another complex thing that we can do, of course, another common request is to do demand analytics or forecasting or create a recommendation solution. And here you have a complete architecture of what you can do using many of the features available in Azure as a complete cloud service that fits together very nice with Azure SQL. So you can have a web storefront, some API that your customer want to query, your data integration with local files exported by existing ERP warehouse and IoT that all flows in into Azure SQL. And probably they are going to use the transactional part of Azure SQL, the row store. But at the same time, the same row store can also be used as a column store without data movement, without copying data somewhere, without you know, having to duplicate the data, which usually would introduce some latency. But on the same table, you can have the transactional row store storage and the analytical and column store. And of course, this will enable all the analytical processing in near real time, because as soon as you read, as soon as you write, you can also read from the analytical part of it. And everything happens also with the scale out option that we saw before. So really there is an incredible opportunity here to create something that just a few years ago was almost impossible, really, really, really expensive.
Yeah, and it seems like also a lot of these things are just easy for me to set up, right? Like, yes, it's not like I'm having to create these architectures and deploy a bunch of custom code. Like, a lot of the integrations are already there.
Right, especially for the HTAP scenarios, you really don't have to do anything, because Azure SQL will automatically use the row store or the column store depending on the query you write. And this is because we have a query processor that has been optimized in the last like 30 years. So I would say now it's quite smart to understand what is the best for
awesome.
You. Yep. And that's talking about real time and complex things that now are much easier. Mm-hmm. For example, personalization and fraud detection is a common requirement today to make sure that you have, as a user, a personalized experience. And at the same time, companies can detect fraud as soon as possible. So it is another example where the transactional row store and the analytical store works very well together. And not only it is, as you can see, very simple architecture. You just load your data into Azure SQL using the transactional row store, and I would say automatically for you it is turned into a column store that can be used by analytics or monitoring and alerting. But as you can see, the architecture is very simple. And we have a couple of customers that we just did a case study with them that are using, ideally, this architecture to exactly do fraud detection and personalization. So ClearSale is one. They are using Hyperscale. And as you can see in the solution, the details, EventUp, Azure Function, to basically do exactly that, fraud prevention. So this is one customer that is successfully using the architecture we just discussed. Another one is Clear, and this instead is validating credit card transaction. So it's another important business where you don't know how much you can grow, and that's why they decided to go with Hyperscale, because again, they can grow up to 100 terabytes without any problem. And that is well integrated with the whole Azure infrastructure, because it allows to ingest data, process it, and consume it using Power BI, for example. So I think this shows how flexible and how well integrated is Azure SQL within a complex ecosystem like Azure, and that allows you to really create complex solution with, I would say, a minimal effort compared to what it was possible in the past.
Thanks so much. I mean, I think you've really shown us not only, you know, that the possibilities are endless, but that also people are already kind of, you know, investing and putting our architectures into practice. So
yeah.
I think that's really powerful. So thanks for sharing it with us. I think we have some references that we'll share in the description. And thanks for joining us today on Data Exposed. Be sure to like this video or subscribe or comment and let us know what you're using Azure SQL database for.